Okay, welcome everybody. We're going to get started. My name is Zachary Goldman. I'm the Executive Director of the Center on Law and Security here at NYU and a co-founder of the Center for Cybersecurity. It's an enormous pleasure and honor to welcome the Commission on Enhancing National Cybersecurity for its hearing this morning. There's literally no better group of people to help think through the types of challenges that we face in cybersecurity. The commission was established pursuant to an executive order issued in February, and the goal is to create actionable and sustainable recommendations to increase preparedness, to deter, disrupt, and interfere with malicious activity, and help the country figure out better how to respond and recover from cyber incidents. It's a threat, as we all know, that is of greatest strategic significance, but which manifests itself as attacks on private companies, large and small. And so I think therein lies the challenge of devising a set of solutions that are sustainable. And I think it's worth noting also that at the same time that the commission was established in February, the president announced a number of measures also aimed at achieving a more coherent and cohesive approach to cybersecurity. That's it. I'll just stop with that word of welcome, ask our Dean, Trevor Morrison, to say a few words of welcome, and then turn things over to the commission for what I expect will be an extremely interesting discussion. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Trevor Morrison. Thanks to Zach Goldman and to Sam Raskoff of our Center on Law and Security, as well as the Center on Cybersecurity, which is a joint undertaking between the law school here and the Tandon Engineering School at NYU. And this, on NYU's behalf, those two centers are helping to host today's proceedings, which are terribly important. And I won't repeat everything that Zach said, except to underscore, I think, the immense importance of this set of issues and the great distinction of this commission that's been put together, the Commission on Enhancing National Cybersecurity, to think through in a serious way the set of issues facing us now in the cybersecurity space. The commission is full of deep expertise. It's great to see my former colleague Tom Donilon, having worked together in the White House a number of years ago. It's great to welcome you to NYU, Tom. So without further ado, let's begin today with the first panel. Thank you all for being here.
Good morning, everybody. This meeting is now open, and with that, I'm going to ask our chair, Tom Donilon, to begin with opening remarks before our first panel on finance.
Thanks, Kirsten. First of all, thank you to Dean Morrison and Professor Goldman for welcoming us here today, and for the NYU Center in Law and Security and the NYU Center for Cybersecurity to host us today. As Trevor said, he and I spent many hours in the Situation Room. As I remarked at our last meeting with General Alexander, I've not been in a meeting with Trevor where there was actually natural light, and certainly not an audience, at least that we knew of. So thank you very much, Trevor and Zach, for hosting us here. They very much appreciate you putting this, together. And you, as we, on the commission, as the president has underscored, obviously acknowledge that cybersecurity, the potential for cyber attacks, has become one of the most pressing challenges for our country, our government, our economy, and for our, for us as individuals and American citizens. So we have important work to do. This workshop today is the first of a number of workshops that we're going to be conducting around the country. They'll have a focus in each case, a topical focus, depending on the region that we're in. Obviously, today, finance and insurance was a natural to do. But given, I don't want to say, but given the breadth of experience of our panelists today, and you can see that through the prepared statements, I'd hope you won't confine yourself just to a specific remarks around your specific industry, but we really would like to hear your general advice from the experiences you have, because we have some of the most experienced individuals in the field of cybersecurity generally before us today. What we're about doing here is trying to develop a national agenda for the next 5 to 10 years. That's the horizon set forth in the president's executive order. And essentially, in a shorter term, what we're doing is really setting an agenda for the next president. Our due date is December 1st, 2016. The President, President Obama, will review the report, and then our plan will be to present it to the next president-elect, essentially as a transition set of proposals, recommendations, and analysis for him or her to consider. And I think, my own experience in transitions, I think that'll be quite valuable for the next president, frankly. We really are at really interesting points, I think, in this discussion. I think can make a real contribution for the next president. Today, we're going to work through three specific areas. One, looking at the cybersecurity challenges and experience in the financial services industry, an industry which is, I think, generally acknowledged to be out front, had the most success, put the most resources into cybersecurity, yet as we see in the newspapers in the last couple of weeks, still facing serious challenges. So we'd like to learn about from you all what are the points that we can take and broaden in terms of experience? What are the challenges that you still face? We're going to work through. The next panel will be on insurance. I'm very interested in this because I do think that history has taught us, and Randy Milch's paper today in the testimony goes through the history of insurance. A little bit of the history of insurance in the United States can be very powerful in terms of driving standards and mitigating costs. And last, we'll have a research and development panel. We have some really terrific people today to talk about the latest potential technical solutions. And again, trying to think through what does an R&D agenda look like for the next president, for the next 5 to 10 years for the country? Where should we be focusing? What does an investment agenda look like for the country? So with that, Sam, do you have any?
No, I think Tom's done
okay.
A great job.
All right. Thank you, Sam. All right. we'll go to the panel. And again, welcome. Thanks for preparing the testimony. I feel like we've already gotten some terrific ideas and contributions from you all. And so we'll begin with your statements, and we'll begin a conversation today. So why don't we start? We'll go from left to right, Marc, and then Greg and Phil, and we'll work it through.
Thank you, and good morning. I'm the Chief Information Officer for American Express, and in that role, I oversee the global technology organization, including the cyber function. To Tom and Sam and the commission, thank you for the invitation. I plan to discuss three areas very briefly: the threat landscape, just a couple of quick minutes, some thoughts on how we believe the government can and help enhance the security and protections across the private sector, and then finally, I'll do a quick pass through what I believe characterize some of the differences in financial services in terms of how we operate.
Marc, I'm sorry, is your mic on?
I believe it is.
Can you hear
is
it? Okay?
Yeah, okay, thank you. So let me start briefly with the threat landscape. And as you know, in recent years, we've seen an explosion, a substantial increase in the cybersecurity threat environment. And just to give you a couple of quick items to give you a sense of the scale of what we see. So every day, we would estimate that there are tens of thousands of attempts to probe or scan the network perimeters of our companies for vulnerabilities. Across the industry, I would venture well in excess of 100,000 attempts every day. On average, we see 5 to 10 new phishing campaigns every day. I don't mean phishing campaign as an email, but broad scale and focused phishing campaigns every day of the week. And as you probably know, phishing of employees and spear phishing of senior executives has been the primary attempted attack vector for malware against our sector. And then if I use threat indicators as a proxy for the level of activity that we see, we source primarily open source, although there are some information exchange that happens within the industry through a group called FSISAC, but we'll see threat indicators 30,000 or more every week, more than 1.5 million threat indicators that we source on an annual basis. So that gives you a little bit of a sense of the landscape that we exist in. Let me segue as the commission formulates its recommendations, would ask you to consider a couple of items related to the way in which the public sector and the private sector interact. I had a range of topics. I'm going to really focus on one and touch a second one lightly. And the first one I would characterize as very tactical, but I believe it's actually one of the best return on investment actions that the private sector and the public sector can take together, and that is the in the context of information sharing. So as you may be aware, we, American Express, and others in the industry have provided support for the legislation that passed at the end of last year. My mantra has been for some time now, one company's attack could be the entire nation's defense. And really, from my view, there is no excuse for the same attack technique or technology working twice in our country, but they do, and often. I'd like to see aggressive acceleration of real-time within and across industry information sharing of threat indicators. I think there's been very good progress, but I would tell you that I feel at the pace at which the country is moving, public and private sector together, we're probably years away from the vision that I would characterize, which would be, if I'm attacked today, I should be able to share that across industries by tomorrow. I mean, I'd settle for by tomorrow. It should be real time, but I would settle for by tomorrow. And I would tell you that the pace at which the country is moving, that's probably years away from a practical perspective. And I believe the capabilities are in place. I believe the legislative support is in place. And I believe the technology is largely in place to enable a vision like that. Related to information sharing, I would add it's not clear yet how forward-leaning the government will be in sharing cyber threat information developed from its own intelligence sources as compared to information on cyber threats that are shared within and across the private sector. And again, I would encourage the commission to look to see how we might accelerate the government leaning in and sharing with its sources from an intelligence perspective, because we believe that would be very helpful in protecting our businesses and our customers. The second area from a government perspective I'll touch on very, very lightly, and I'd be remiss if I didn't cover this, is related to the way in which the role of the government in the front end of the attack cycle. And I would say in contrast to the physical world where roles and responsibilities are very clear across the life cycle, and I realize in the cyber world it's much more complicated, but in the context of preventing or disrupting nation state or related cyber attacks against industries like ours, I would say the role of the government could be substantially clearer and more forward leaning. And that's in contrast to the back end of the life cycle where we are, where companies in response and recovery, I think roles are much clearer and the government's role across Homeland Security, FBI, Secret Service is very positive and very helpful. But that said, nation state attacks land at our doorstep and it's very unclear the role that the government plays in preventing those from occurring. Segueing then to the financial services industry, what I've tried to do is call out the, I think, characteristics of what we do that I feel might be somewhat differentiated relative to other industries and to the extent that they're useful for the commission as you formulate your recommendations. I'll go through them very quickly. There's eight of them. First, I'll note that in our industry, there's a deeply embedded risk management mindset and skill set. As you would well know, we in part make money by managing risk, extending a loan, authorizing a payment, taking a position. These are all areas that we actively manage and mitigate. And there's an embedded mindset and skill set around understanding these kinds of risks, credit risk, market risk, and we've extended it to operational risk. Deep in what we do is the concept of inherent risk and residual risk, and we apply that, I think, quite effectively to cybersecurity. The second area that I think somewhat differentiates our industry, and I think, Tom, you referenced it, is the investment levels. That's really tied, I think, to the risk framework. So as we look at the outside world at inherent risk, that really does drive in our models how we invest in operational risk and controls and cybersecurity specifically. And I think it would not be unheard of to see companies in the industry having doubled their spends in information security over the last number of years. The third area where I see that financial services may be a bit different than other industries is in the level of collaboration. I think the actual level of collaboration within financial services is very strong in the context of cyber. While we compete in many other contexts, we do leverage both the financial services ISAC, but even more importantly in some ways, or additionally, we have, I think, a level of collaboration and an informal network where we do tend to work together in cyber. By way of an example, the financial services industry came together and created a venture called Sultra, which is a market automation solution that we're trying to deploy within the industry and across other industries for information sharing. The fourth area where I think we are differentiated from some sectors is our interactions with the startup community. So in the cyber arms race, and especially against our collective adversaries, I think there's a very high level of leverage of the startup community. It would be typical to see cyber startup products and solutions, 5, 10, 15 plus of them, embedded in the security fabric of what we do, and for us to continuously evaluate and refresh the role that those companies play, because we see a tremendous amount of innovation coming from the startup community. The fifth area that I would cite that I think differentiates us somewhat from other industries is the application of big data, decision sciences, machine learning against cyber challenges. As you would expect, those capabilities were probably built early on for business applications, fraud, credit, market risk management. But that said, most of us, I believe, have applied pretty effectively those same decision sciences and big data capabilities to the cyberspace, especially insider risk, but among across a number of different areas. Sixth area I would suggest relates to something a little more narrow, but it's a separation of personal and professional in terms of use of the corporate network. The seventh area that I would cite relates to, I think, the way that our industry is engaged with cloud and with cloud providers. Each of us is in various stages with external cloud technologies, and it's appropriate to what we do. But I believe because of the standards that we set are quite high, our interactions with the various cloud providers have actually, I believe, influenced and shaped the security components of cloud offerings. I think we've been very helpful in that. And then the final area that I would reference, maybe a little bit more specifically to the payment sector and protecting customers from cyber criminals, there are numerous companies, ours and others, and in fintech, very active in deploying tokenized or encrypted payment solutions. These are online, as you check out in store, with various checkout mechanisms, whether it's wallets, chips on cards, mobile pay devices like Apple Pay, Android Pay, Samsung Pay. And then in addition, I would say in the context of online identity, in addition to traditional authentication factors, a number of us are very focused on what I'd call almost analytic authentication, which is to say it matters almost a little bit less who you say you are. We use context, we use big data, we use machine learning to establish that we know who you are, independent in some ways almost of who you say you are. Those are my remarks. Thank you very much, and happy to take questions now or at the end of the panel. Okay.
Thank you. Greg Rattray, I'm the head of global cyber partnerships for JP Morgan Chase. I think my remarks will actually build nicely on Marc's, and in general, I think I agree, with what Marc said. We're going to focus, I think, our remarks really on the need for a stronger, private sector government collaboration in this area. And to begin, I really want to provide some background on, how we see cybersecurity, the depth of our effort, and, I think the need to uplift how we work closely with government. It's a fundamental concern for JPMC, the firm and its clients. It's in the strategic priorities of the firm. So with all the objectives for JP Morgan Chase, cybersecurity is in the top set of objectives approved annually by the firm. And in 2016, the plan is to spend over $600 million have over 2,000 people working on cybersecurity. The point's already been made, and I see Phil at partnership meetings in the financial services sector all the time. We are strongly supportive of things like the Financial Sector Coordinating Council and the Financial Services ISAC. We think those collaborative efforts play an essential role in our defenses and protect the financial services as a whole. We hope we also are taking a leadership role across industry to examine, detection, response, and recovery actions related to significant cyber-induced disruptions to the sector's payment platforms. We work closely with Treasury, DHS, FBI, and others, participate in the full range of public-private partnerships, things like the cyber information sharing platforms at DHS, the new automated information sharing effort that stems from the legislation. We're also highly supportive of the NIST framework as a basis for constructing cyber programs and oversight. Treasury has run a series of events with the four, you know, I talked about the Financial Services Sector Coordinating Council. We participate fully in those events. We think exercises are a crucial way to practice, but you have to practice based on capabilities and plans, as I'll get to in a moment. We think we need to be able to jointly respond to cyber events. In general, you know, while we find that the government has very strongly stated, you know, the significance of cybersecurity as a major challenge and established broad programs to engage with, in partnership with the private sector, the programs do not necessarily meet the needs of a firm like ours in terms of enhancing cyber defense of a company that's strongly invested in developing mature capabilities. We seek to build on the strong partnership we've developed, and we hope that a prioritized focus on dedicated government support capabilities to large firms like ours that have more resources and already have implemented robust cyber defense programs. We understand the strategic importance of cybersecurity, and we're fully invested in continually improving our cyber defense. So I'm going to stress a number of things specifically we hope the commission would take on board as thinking towards recommendations about improvements in the government programs. Information sharing. We really need predictive, actionable threat intelligence driven by the requirements worked with the private sector in access to the right dedicated government classified reporting. And we think services on par with those that are offered by to the defense industrial base through the DIB CERT program at the Defense Computer Crime Center or Cyber Crime Center, and then other efforts like the ICS CERT at DHS that focus on other sectors. There's no dedicated program for the financial services sector. In terms of intelligence and disruptive operations, we think that a national effort to provide intelligence and conduct disruptive operations against organized crime, in addition to against potential nation-state adversaries. Criminal attacks against financial services companies and the associated financial services utilities can have wide-ranging national impacts, and we think those sorts of operations are an essential part of countering the threat. In terms of crisis response and contingency planning, as I've mentioned, there's some work that's been done in terms of exercising. We need to improve those capabilities with investments in a stronger sector exercise program, established joint crisis response protocols and contingency plans for destructive or large-scale attacks. We think systematically important institutions must receive dedicated support in these efforts. We think that the core financial utilities and infrastructure in particular need to have improved cybersecurity and fraud prevention integrated with the efforts that we're undertaking, systems such as Fedwire, and moving to improvement of the overall environment. We'd like to drive efforts with the internet infrastructure and ecosystem providers such as email providers, organizations like ICANN and the domain registrars to reduce the level of malicious activity and improve the environment for our customers and clients. In terms of broader things that are outside the specific realm of cyberspace, we'd like to ensure government resources and leadership or attention are devoted to understanding and addressing as applicable the potential impacts to public and market confidence with clear liquidity guidelines, settlement and cash distribution procedures, updated regulatory guidance and communication strategies in the cases of systemic attacks against the financial services sector. Some of this work is underway, but we think it needs to be brought to a higher level and done more fully. And then finally, efficient access to government resources during cyber events, make sure that we can effectively respond and recover. We think that to implement these priorities effectively, we really have to have clear priorities across all departments and agencies about prioritizing and enhanced support to systemically important firms is authorized and required to protect the critical infrastructure.
Thank you very much. Bill?
All right, thank you. I have five recommendations that are built on our experience in the sector, and I think they complement the remarks that you've just heard. Before I go through them, though, I would point out, and I'd recommend the Commission also consider the fact that cybersecurity is not the only technology and information risk that we have to deal with either as a nation or a sector. There are many other, in some cases, equivalently important risks, whether it's in software reliability and predictability, capacity, resilience, and large parts of our society are challenged with how we digitally transform and manage all of the risks associated with that. Cybersecurity clearly is one of, if not the most critical underpinning of that, and it plays definitely a supporting and supported role in how we manage and mitigate those risks. The five recommendations I have are very much focused on cybersecurity, but again, we should remember that cybersecurity is one of many technology and information risks, and they can interplay with each other positively and negatively if we don't manage things in the correct way. The first recommendation is around how do we integrating cybersecurity into the fabric of our organizations. The first part of that is risk must be integrated. It must be integrated from our boards of directors, through our risk committees, through all levels of our organization to make sure that we're managing and thinking about cybersecurity risk in every business decision from strategy formulation to acquisitions to divestments to other forms of investment. Second, cybersecurity must also be integrated through our technology lifecycle. It's our experience that good cybersecurity comes from good technology management and hygiene, and making sure that an agile and effective technology environment supports cybersecurity and vice versa is extremely critical. And finally, even if risk is well managed and technology is well integrated, we all must plan for the potential that an advanced adversarial technique or other unforeseen circumstance could lead to an event. I think we all recognize there can never be 100% effectiveness here, so it's equally important to plan for recoverability and then to also drill and exercise for the eventuality of some problem occurring, not just within one's own institution, but as a sector as a whole and as a society as a whole. And as Greg and Marc have said, making sure that we drill that across all the capabilities of government. The second would be to continue to build on the public and private partnership work that's happened over the past decade. I think there's been immense increase in capability on threat intelligence sharing. I would agree that we keep needing to do more here. The other thing I would say as well is we probably also should shift, in addition to not just look at threat intelligence sharing, but also sharing more information in suitably anonymized and protected ways about incidents that have occurred and what the root cause of those were, so that we can all collectively share from the experience that people have had in their exposures and then in managing their incidents. I would also point out as well that while the threat intelligence sharing today can often exist in classified forms and requires a number of people in the sector to hold appropriate security clearances for that, one of the things I would recommend for more intelligence sharing, I think we should attempt to desensitize or declassify as much as possible so that information can be more readily used. I don't think the only answer is to find more cleared people in the sector. And then finally, on that second recommendation, I would also recommend that we not only improve cross-sector coordination, but also recognize that this is an international problem. I think all of our businesses, not least in the financial sector, have operations internationally, and we're subject to physical and digital threats in all of the jurisdictions and locations that we operate in. The third recommendation would be to harmonize rules and guidance. There's a multiplicity of frameworks, standards, and guidelines for cybersecurity, many of which are effective and practical, but organizations find it very difficult to choose amongst that myriad of standards and guidelines. So I'd recommend that we continue to focus on the NIST cybersecurity framework, and then in turn making sure that we develop further profiles of that, which in turn can be subject to appropriate certification schemes. I'd also further raise the need for awareness amongst organizations to adopt a strong set of baseline controls. An example of this would be the Center for Internet Security's controls for effective cyber defense. There are many others, but we find those things that have been derived from the SANS top 20 and other examples as being documenting an effective set of baseline controls that are, while not easy to adopt, are not particularly challenging and can deflect many types of attacks. Fourth, I think we must improve the capabilities amongst our people, process, and technology. There needs to be continued emphasis around embedding controls in all products and services. We need to make sure that we're designing security in from the get-go rather than adding it in after the fact. In other words, we need secure products, not just security products. Secondly, I think as well, we should make sure that cybersecurity risk mitigation is not solely the responsibility of designated cybersecurity professionals. We've got to recognize that this is the job of all people in organizations, from business leaders, risk managers, to engineers. And we need to make sure that all of the professional and academic qualifications and training that those people go through contain equivalent training around cybersecurity. In other words, we need more security-minded people, not just more security people. I'd also fully endorse all the efforts around how we're trying to create more trained cybersecurity professionals in the nation to support all our sectors. But I think the only answer can't be to create more cybersecurity professionals. I think we need to create and improve the productivity of the cybersecurity professionals we've already got. And I think a recommendation would be to study more about how we can improve the tools, process, and orchestration to maximize the productivity of the people we've got, not just focusing on creating more of those people. And then the final recommendation would be we need to continue to design for defensibility. Our goal should be to develop technology architectures and deploy those, reduce some of the complexity in our environments to make sure our environments are much more inherently defendable. The good news is many of the new technologies that we're adopting, some of which Marc mentioned, are amenable to such defendability. We've just got to adopt them, eliminate some of the legacy environments, and make sure that we're appropriately using those. And finally, I would close by saying, having said all of this, there may be still some things that are simply so critical that we don't need to connect them to everything else. And there may be some things that we just need to continue to isolate under higher assurance of control, notwithstanding the fact that there's some advantages in their connectedness. So I will close in that remarks. Happy to take questions.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it. And the way I thought we'd proceed is not have kind of a formal, one after another, but rather just have commissioners offer up if they want to ask questions of the panel. I'll start with just one with Bill, because I was focused on one thing that you said, which is another topic we're going to be diving into specifically here, and that is essentially on the Internet of Things. And your point, your fourth point, about trying to essentially get security right from the start, to build products that have security embedded in them as a priority from the get-go, as opposed to trying to catch up later with respect to attaching security to already existing products. Can you talk a little bit about what a mechanism for that might be? There's going to be one of our focuses, how should we think about that? How do we get that dynamic going in the private sector? Because this is not a problem for 5 years from now. This is an issue today.
Right. No, I mean, I think there is and there should be more communication of expected standards, almost in the sense of a set of public safety standards. I know organizations like MITRE and some others, and in fact NIST, have been working on recommendations in this space. I mean, I think some of the devices that we as a society are embedding that technology in have significant safety dimensions to it, and I don't think it would be inappropriate for this to be seen as a set of safety standards for certain types of devices.
You can set the standards, and then but you have to have some mechanism for, if you will, I think communicating to a purchaser of that product that in fact that they meet some sort of standards.
One of the thoughts, Marc, on that, there's no sort of underwriter's laboratory equivalent in cyber, and it struck me, from time to time, because I thought about that. Where would you go to see that products are tested effectively from a security perspective? I'm not sure if that would work or not, but it has come to mind a couple of times for me over the last year or two that there's really no place to go to your point to say, well, did they follow those standards? What's the level of security in that product? Is it safe?
Get kind of a market imprimatur, if you will, right?
Exactly.
Right in the markets. I'll just have one more question and then open up to the commissioners. I take the point on wanting to have more productive cybersecurity specialists, but I wanted to ask the panel a more general question about the market. One of the areas that we're also going to be focusing on is asking the question of whether or not the next president should launch a cyber workforce initiative in terms of trying to create more people. So taking your point, Phil, that you want to have the most productive and best trained people, and you want to embed cyber consciousness more broadly in your workforce, what are you all seeing in terms of market dynamics? You all oversee large organizations. Greg, as you said, you've got 2,000 people in this area. What are you seeing in terms of availability of talent? Do we have a good market? Do we have a market failure? Are we short? And if we are, what can we do about it?
My perspective, and I'd certainly be interested to hear the others, there is a dearth of talent, right? I think that's widely recognized. There is a national initiative for cyber education, right? So at one level, I think the current president has NIST leading a cyber, a national initiative. It is largely an initiative to design rather than to resource the creation of cyber professionals. I don't have a deep knowledge of the budgetary aspects of it, but it's not, it's not paying for people to get trained. It's trying to design what I think is a pretty good program in terms of, what does a cyber workforce look like? We leverage it when we think about how to design our growing workforce. I don't think this is a challenge that, is going to be worked through quickly. I think like most of the issues, I think we have now, awareness is high, and maybe some of these things are primarily resource issues to incentivize people to get a larger number of individuals in. I'll just conclude with saying my operational experience with cyber is the skill sets that are necessary are ones through experiential, that they're not academic skill sets. You need both aspects to it. But as we think about deepening, some of it comes from the fact that people have been working in this field for a number of years. Again, something we can't grow instantaneously. I think our recognition of the challenge has outpaced, the amount of time we've had available to grow professionals in the field.
I think the only other thing I'd add to that is I think when talking about cybersecurity workforce development, we have to unpick which piece of cybersecurity we're talking about. So the type of people that work in our various threat management centers have a different skill set than the people who are working in our infrastructure organizations, who have a different skill set, again, of our software engineers that are building security into the business applications we offer to our customers. Everyone has a different set of skills, development, and requirements, some of which can be trained on the people that are already working in those tasks. Some are more, to Greg's point, more grown as specialists over 5, 10, 15 years, and I think when we look at this, we should break that out into the different requirements, because everyone will be subject to different automation, different education. Some of the right answers might be to embed more, for example, on software development, more secure software development practices across all the computer science and engineering degrees in the nation, as opposed to just focusing on developing the expertise in dedicated cybersecurity qualifications.
I think if I just think about the market experience, it's very competitive, and the costs of cybersecurity professionals have gone up substantially. I think part of what we've seen in our industry is other industries are waking up to the threat, and actually you'll see people from financial services being hired into other sectors because, to your earlier point, there's probably a little bit more experience there. My impression is the place where we are the shortest is not in terms of capability, it's not at the senior levels or even at the entry level, it's sort of in the middle. And accelerating speed to effectiveness for people, I think, would be an interesting area to think about. To Greg's comments that I find we can hire people out of school, but it takes years for them to become effective. And to the extent that there are programs that could help accelerate that effectiveness, I think that could be very interesting.
Yeah, again, this is a broad question that I would like to get some perspective on from you guys, since you're technology oriented. If you think about the great benefit of the internet, it's open, it's easy to use, therefore you'll have billions of things on it, which make it very complicated to manage. Another thought would be to solve the problem is you simplify it. You would take elements of your critical infrastructures. You would know better your industry than mine. In fact, I don't want to give an example. You could think of examples, say collaboration with you all in the central banking system. You could lock it down end to end the way you would have done it pre-internet and have it totally secure, totally encrypted, very simple, right, for critical elements of the infrastructure. Through simplification, you have less complexity, less demand on the spending, less demand on the skills, et cetera, et cetera. Is this an alternative for things that are critically important to society, your industry, the utility structure of the country, the grid, et cetera? Is this an alternative to the openness, which is the greatness of the internet, by the way, which we all love, but is there an alternative if you could prioritize elements that you would define as critical and do it the way you would have done it pre-internet?
I think things are always going to need to be connected, if not for commercial value, but also to enable the management of other risks. Now, having said that, I think the value of more simple component-based systems where there's expected behavior from the different interfaces, and as you compose them together, you're more likely to have predictable, safe, and secure behavior, I think, is the right way to go. The challenge is, not specifically on the financial sector, but more broadly, is that's not how things evolved over the past 30 years. So I think, again, looking into some of the things that organizations like CMU and the Software Engineering Institute, the things that have gone on in MITRE around how to design resilient systems, I think the good news is there's a lot of very commendable research on how to do this, more study on how to increase the take-up of those design principles into the market, and then how to transition from legacy, more complex systems into that new, more simpler design is something that I think we should focus on a lot more.
Right. Just to add to that, actually, and then a question. In the payments industry, the idea of Sam of having EMV core, which creates standards for chip and tokenization across American Express, Visa, MasterCard, and the banks, has enabled a platform that's foundational on which you could build individual capabilities for companies to be adequately distinguished from each other in a commercial proposition. That's kind of what you're getting at. My question on that would be, fell back to you for a second, what's the role that a federal government would play to do that versus industries doing it themselves? Because that's traditionally the problem, right? And if you've got any thoughts on that, I'd love to hear you answer that. Then I have a different question for the panel after that.
Yeah, so I think there's definitely continued opportunity and plenty of examples where the public and private sector has worked and continues to work on setting standards. I think these things need to be developed as a collaboration. The NIST cyber framework was a classic example. Yeah. There's a lot of stuff that's happened through the financial services sector coordinating council, through various of the industry associations. I think there's a lot of energy in all of these spaces, from frameworks down to detail, where there's great partnership going on. We probably need to keep doing more, but it's not like there's nothing been happening in that space.
Right. You've heard several of us mention NIST. I just want to put an exclamation point on that. To the extent you're looking for what good looks like in terms of public and private collaboration, I think pretty much universally our industry, and I think others, would say that the development of the NIST framework is probably one of the best experiences we've had in terms of collaboration and in terms of the outcome.
May I keep going for a sec? One more. My concern is that the weakest link in the chain is the place from where traditionally exposure happens. You're all representing relatively large institutions that have resources and capabilities to be able to do things yourself. I'm deeply concerned about the fact that smaller banks could be quite easily accessed and broken into, and through that would be created large wire frauds and the like, which would impact your institutions. You may be able to stop them because you may be well-equipped and trained and productive and capable and have the right culture embedded in your institution to do so. But as you've just seen in a central bank of a country and another bank in Vietnam, that's the weak link. A lot of the statements you've all made are talking about frameworks that would make sense for you. Can you address the issue of how you think about your smaller partners, because they'll impact you directly, and how you feel about that part of the industry?
I guess I'll start. So I think you're correct. I think that's acknowledged that how we interact with all the others in the ecosystem. I think this sector spends a lot of energy actually trying to bring a broader and broader set of players. The financial services ISAC, I think, is over 4,000 or 5,000. It's over 4,000. So the small institutions are in. I think there's a mechanisms for them to participate. I think things like the NIST framework apply broadly. So, the notion that we're all lining up on the same basic principles. Phil also talked about sort of basic baseline controls that I think we need all institutions, independent of scale. All institutions also have to understand dependencies, right? I do definitely agree that there are weakest link aspects to this. The system has to, find what are the most important links as well. At the end of the day, every institution is not equal in terms of risk at the national level. So I think the notion of strengthening the entire set of institutions is a good one. I think there's balancing with that, a notion of making sure that, we're also focused on the key aspects of the system that may need some specific investments and collaborations to secure.
Yeah. And I think just to build on that, I agree with the concern, and I think that the sector as a whole, through its industry associations and other mechanisms, is keenly aware of the need to not just design large firm solutions and to make sure that whatever is happening has applicability to the small firms as well, and that's something that I think a lot of the industry associations have been doing a pretty good job of. Not to say that there aren't always improvements to be made, but that's something that's very front and center in our minds about how we think of this as a sector-wide problem, not just a large firm problem.
Right. But really, I think it's a great question, and I think the problem statement really extends to small and medium-sized businesses in every sector. Right. And by way of example, the Chamber of Commerce, with sponsorship from the private sector where we participate, has run education sessions for small and medium-sized businesses on the NIST framework. And so there are efforts to try to build awareness and understanding at that level, not just our suppliers, but companies writ large. I do think it's very difficult for small, medium-sized businesses to look at the ecosystem, even something as good as the NIST framework, and translate that into what should I do? There's an understanding, but then from there to what should I do as a medium-sized business, I think would be exceedingly difficult without the resources that companies like we have. And back to my earlier comments, we work with dozens of startups. The energy that we put into understanding that environment, selecting the partners, deploying those inside our fabric is not something that would be easily achieved by medium-sized companies. And so I do think there is an opportunity for the commission to think about recommendations that would support taking the NIST framework, which is actionable if you know how to action it, but more difficult for medium-sized companies.
Ajay, it's not just about the small and medium, but it's also about weak links, right? I mean, because we've obviously seen in the last few weeks the public attention to the SWIFT vulnerabilities with weaker banking systems in Bangladesh and Vietnam. How do you all think about that problem?
Well, go ahead, please.
I think we, as a team, a private, public, financial services, government, need to understand the system as a whole, right? And, when things are identified, like the weaknesses, that have been taken advantage of recently, we need to attend to not just the large firms, but the dependencies the system has on, you know, the payment systems, the clearing systems, and ensure that those fundamental pieces are as strong as the large institutions are. And I think that's something our firm is working on. We've got collaborative activities going on with some of those organizations coming up this year.
Add clarity on this, because there are probably some things you three can't say about the SWIFT access in your question, but I think it drives to and would like your agreement or disagreement to your statements on public-private partnerships. How do you interact with the government when you have a serious problem like what happened at the Bank of Bangladesh? What does the government know? How do you go back and forth and do that in a very timely manner? And what are the rules? I think what Phil brought out, try to declassify as much as you can, but you have to have a mechanism that can work back and forth. All three brought out that public-private partnership. And I think, you know, just watching the three, it reminds me eerily of my former days sitting in that position with other people up here. But it seems to me that if you brought out public-private partnerships, what you really need from the government is that real time, we see this going on, here's what we're doing, here's what you need to defend against it, and that is that fair?
More than fair. And sort of my comments, I tried to highlight that, but I went through it very, very quickly. In the back end, if a company is in trouble, I think the rules of engagement are somewhat clearer, and there's good support from agencies like Homeland Security, FBI, Treasury, and our industry. But on the front end, there's relatively little interaction relative to these are the threats that are in front of you or unfolding real time, and here's how you can defend against them, or even how the government might intervene in some cases in the context of a nation-state attack.
Yeah. Well, and I think as well it's important and to look at the different array of threats that face organizations, not just in the financial sector, and to look across government and see are they configured to monitor and interdict those threats. If it's just for nation state, then that's not all the threats. The question as well is, are all parts of government aligned around surveilling and managing the organized criminal threat, for example?
Yeah, to go a step farther, and Phil's very aware of this work, and we as a sector are working on contingency plans to identify the top tier scenarios, and we'd like to do that in hand with government. My belief is that with joint contingency plans, we can think through the types of questions that would arise, responses would be quicker. Phil, I think, hits on a key point that hopefully I mentioned in my opening remarks, which is we think it's more than just nation states, that some of the financial crimes that are being committed, you know, also rise to the level of needing joint contingency planning and government support, or at least collaboration, in terms of quickly addressing what's happening and responding effectively.
This will be quick. It's on this point, which it builds on it. But historically, when we were all working on this issue of information sharing, there was great concern with an industry of litigation risk. Has that been resolved?
I mean, the legislation passed, and so in theory, it's been resolved. I think it needs to be probably activated and tested to know. But I think it was a very good step forward. But to my comments earlier, I think we've got lots of forces amassing in support of activating the sort of vision of what's embedded in that legislation. But I do feel the pace is very slow.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. So I have a three-part question. My question is, what is the worst case scenario that you envision for the financial sector in terms of the actual sequence of events, meaning the actor, the actions, the impact, and response for the financial sector? Second, how could that scenario have been prevented? And third, what ideally would you like to see happen so that we can prevent? What's needed in terms of public and private partnerships and perhaps interactions across the different sectors as well?
Do you want to go?
I'll go, because I don't think I'm at liberty to define a specific scenario, right? I think we have been focusing the discussion on the need for joint identification of a number of things. I mean, my background tells me you don't want to pick one thing and seek to fix that. You want to identify the top set of things, I use contingency as a word, or the scenarios, and make sure that you've practiced responding and you have the right procedures in place. The sector actually has an all-hazards playbook. The government's still working on a national cyber response framework, which I think would be very, very useful. Good work's been done to figure out how to work together. My belief is that needs to be substantially strengthened in order to actually respond effectively. I think what we can do is learn how to react quickly and effectively together, deeply, to contingencies, not bet on a single one. So I think the answer is investment in contingency planning and response, not sort of avoiding one specific scenario.
You guys could say, yeah, that would be bad without putting any of you at risk, which is, generally speaking, the financial sector is built in a virtual world, and closing the books is a virtual world. The disruption or destruction of data in that environment would have catastrophic effects, especially on key parts of the banking sector. I think the financial sector recognizes this, has made great progress, but I think that's the biggest concern. Is that fair?
Just to build on Greg's point, I don't think there's any one worst case scenario. I think it's context specific by institution, by market, by product. But you look across the spectrum of everything associated with threats to confidentiality, integrity, and availability, you can combine any of them, and that could be a bad event. Right.
I believe some work has been done by Homeland Security in concert with Treasury on defining some of these kinds of scenarios that might be worth looking at.
So I guess what I'm trying to get at is that on 9/11, a lot of things happened, a lot of protocols were people were unaware of the protocols that they should have followed. People were unable to deal with the fact that there was a second plane that was hijacked, right, because they were so busy focusing on the first. People weren't called that should have been called, even though there were documented policies and processes for those things to happen. And so I'm curious, what would it take for us to be able to prevent something like that in your sector? What kinds of policies, processes, systems do we need in place to help the financial sector?
Well, so I think, again, to Greg's point, there has been a large amount of work sponsored through the industry associations and the Department of Treasury on the development of the all-hazards playbooks. There's been a whole series of drills and exercises between the financial sector, the Department of Treasury, various government departments and agencies, and that approach of identifying the scenarios and preparing them through drills and lining up better capability from government to support that is the work that's been going on. Now, obviously, it would take too long to go through specifics, and it's probably not the right forum to go through that, but there has been a lot of work on those all hazards playbooks.
And do you feel that enough work has been done, or do we?
My sense is it could be deeper. Right. If we look at how we build our response capabilities against other national security contingencies, there's large investments. There are government organizations dedicated to, building the planning, bringing it together. I think while very good work has been done, particularly in the recent period, it needs to get deeper. Right. And this is largely a resource challenge, I think, as opposed to a conceptual challenge. We know we need response plans and contingency plans. I think there are some issues related to access and sensitivity of information, and those things need to be improved as well.
In order of maturity, most mature would be our ability to respond within one company. Next would be across companies in an industry, and by far least mature is private sector, public sector. And I would say the sort of rules of engagement, clarity of roles and responsibilities, understanding where to go to accomplish what, even the means by which you communicate one to the other, all those things, basics, are, I think, being worked out. The very first of these kinds of exercises, not held that long ago, was more about, like, what do you do versus what do we do? And understanding the private sector, where I think, for example, the public sector, in many cases, individuals don't fully understand what we do or how we do it, and there's an education process at the beginning. So that's the least mature, I would say.
Are any of these exercises held with other global, international, non-US banks or financial sector companies?
Yeah, so there was an exercise last year, which was joint US-UK.
Thank you.
The question Andy's asking, of course, is the kind of fundamental question, which is, if you had one of these catastrophic scenarios, we can think about this. It's sitting here today. What are you pretty sure that we wish we would have done beforehand, right? You know, what would we see ourselves doing the day after that, you know, kind of when you step back, it's pretty clear to us that we should be doing today. Maybe it's around the information sharing, speed and quality. Maybe it's around different structural kinds of things. But that's a question for us to consider to go forward. We actually, I think, as a commission, can actually do something about clarification with respect to roles at various stages in a problem.
One thing that would be a little more preventative is if the type of deep ability of the country to understand emerging threats was applied to threats to the financial system the same way it's applied to other national security threats. You know, we gathered the intelligence about, you know, actors that might be developing capabilities, and we had some warning, you know, of those things, which will require a refocus of, you know, assets within, you know, their appropriate agencies on the specific challenges to the sector, right? So,
the other thing I would say is, if you're not planning already, I would recommend that some sessions with the sector-specific agencies, Treasury, Energy. Most of the sector-specific agencies have been pretty engaged on digging into these types of questions and looking at the inter-sector issues. For example, the interplay between finance, telecom, and energy is something that I know those agencies are spending a lot of time on. So if you weren't planning on that, I would definitely recommend spending time with the sector-specific agencies.
That the government can actually go after the bad guys and stop them. I don't see that this is a sustainable situation for our country or any other, that the private sector should be made to borne billions of dollars in defensive costs when in any other scenario, logic dictates you go after the bad guys. And I'm trying to figure out how we got to this point. And my question, for each of you, although not diplomatic, I think is necessary if we're going to take bold actions, because I'm trying to figure out if we've lost confidence that the government can actually protect us in these areas. And in order to do that, I would like, if you can, to describe what you believe in this area of private sector government collaboration to go after the bad guys. What do you view as the worst failure of the government to support your industry in times of threat crisis, and what can we learn from it so that it doesn't happen again? And what is the best success of the government and the private sector in going after the threat actors to reduce
this pandemic of criminal and nation state activity against our infrastructure. Mr. Gordon, if we could start with you.
That's what did you get me into? I think, I think we're this is a much more complicated problem. I think I made reference to the physical world versus the virtual world. It is a much more complicated problem than the physical world, and the sort of attempts at intrusion that occur every day have almost become a course of business. I think for us. For everyone in the industry. And I guess I would go back in many ways to sort of my comments about the places where I think the government could be more helpful over time, and I think where efforts have been made. The first, information sharing. I do think that there is a very big opportunity here. My vision of it is, as I said earlier, one company's attack is the entire nation's defense. Now, that's still playing defense, but at least it's an aggressive defense. And I think there's a role to play that would help all of us in that context, including the sharing in that context of classified signatures that would help us defend ourselves. I think that's one. I think the second area, which is very complicated, is the role that the government can or should play in the context of preventing, disincentivizing norms of behavior, consequences for either, and again, the lines blur, but I'll say nation states or other entities that mean us harm, could include organized global cyber criminal organizations. But I think that aspect of the role is probably less clear to me relative to, let's say, the physical world. I think that is a place where there could be an opportunity. And I appreciate the passion in your question, by the way.
I'm fearing that no one's going to be able to give me worst case and best case of success so that we can make sure that the worst things don't happen again and the best things that we're doing can be studied and emphasized and built upon. So I'll accept that as perhaps a risk of the forum. But to the extent anyone would like to be able to contribute actual areas where the government and the private sector are getting it right then so that we can make this into a more aspirational, affirmative, positive question,
Steve,
I'll be happy to do that.
So one area that works well is the NCFTA at Pittsburgh, right, where you have, a nonprofit-led collaboration. Government, law enforcement is present there, real information is shared that's actionable, fraud is reduced because of the, co-seeding of public and private people going after, in this case, certain sets of the criminal activity. So I think looking for a positive model, I think that's a very good one, and I know there's plans to sort of extend, that. I think the area that's the challenge, right, that you've sort of been driving at, and I know Phil and I have both mentioned it, Marc just mentioned it, is this seam around, significant, we probably need a term for it, organized crime that creates national level concerns, right? And I think my experience with this and my current perspective is it's not clear, who can apply the full range of authorities to go after that type of adversary with vigor and be disruptive. And then, it's in my opening remarks, I think that needs to get added to the agenda in the clear way that we've declared if nation states are, conduct attacks or make transgressions, I think the nation's clearer now about deterring those sorts of things and that we will respond. I think with the types of potentially nationally threatenized, organized, national threats posed by organized criminal activity, the same sorts of things need to be in place.
So I think there's been lots of examples of success. I mean, so the fairly well-documented public success, some of the things that law enforcement with the FSISAC, along with companies like Microsoft did on coordinated botnet takedowns and various other activities. So, and I think there's been plenty of examples of where that's been done with existing legal and other frameworks. The one thing I'd just say, though, and is you know, we're a commission on enhancing national cybersecurity, but this is an inherently international and connected problem, and that's something that I think I would recommend the commission look deeply at, because as I think we all appreciate, you can't put a national geographic border around these things, and I think especially on organized criminal activity, international coordination and cooperation amongst law enforcement and other agencies worldwide, I think is going to be continue to be critical.
Thank you. I wanted to follow up, Greg, on a point that you made earlier about the importance of systemically important firms and componentry within the financial markets. I think that in the wake of the financial crisis, that term was created mostly to help people think about capital requirements and resiliency within asset pricing and volatility in the markets. But I think it's worth exploring whether we can define institutions and components of the financial markets that we deem to be systemically important from a cyber standpoint. And maybe there's a different definition that we should use to determine which enterprises those may be, and also to take a look at whether or not we can, in fact, do something to bolster their defenses and resilience in order to help to prevent a disruption that might come down the road. Is there a way that you would define that term as it relates to security for the financial services markets, and also what would you do to bolster their defenses?
So I don't know that I have a specific definition. I think it's an analytic problem. I think it's one that both the sector, in terms of the sector coordinating council, collaborates with Treasury to work on that. You know, the remarks that I gave at the start were really focused on the recommendations I'd make, right? I do think we find, as, you know, a very large financial institution, that programs designed to help all companies, and which is important because there is the issue of, you know, small and medium enterprises being ready and being links in the system, don't necessarily provide the very high level of defense we'd want out of the full set of systemic institutions, which are not all just the firms, right? There's certainly the utilities that service the sector, and I think attention needs to go there. But, you know, some of the things we've talked about in terms of joint planning and readiness, having the deep understanding of the threat and, you know, the intelligence to support that. I think there are investments to be made to sort of make sure that you can resource those programs. You know, our understanding is agencies like DHS that have a lot of customers to service, you know, have challenges focusing on, you know, some of the deeply systemic threats.
Would you recommend that we look at things that we deem to be systemically important as a priority when we make the recommendations, as opposed to a broader approach to everything at once, or tier them in their importance?
I think, you know, it's natural that you've got to understand both the systemically, you know, important as well as the broad. So I think maybe the tiering is sort of, you know, what we're driving at here.
And in fact, just to build on that, and again, to I think looking at not just, obviously this is a finance panel, so we're inclined to talk Treasury, but looking across each of the sector-specific agencies and how they've been thinking about ranking in order of systemic risk, because I think a lot of that activity has actually been happening, and so looking at the output of that I think would be valuable for the Commission.
Right. Hi, so thank you. I have a question. I wanted to get a little more detail about the concept of information sharing, which in many circles comes across, frankly, as a technical platitude. But I strongly suspect when the three of you are talking about information sharing that there's something very, a set of very specific technical and policy concepts. But before I do that, I was just reflecting on the maybe polar opposite comments from Stephen and Sam. And I just wanted to make the comment publicly that the tremendously empowering technology of the internet enables a 15-year-old kid to start a company or to have access to finance in far-off places of the world. Of course, that same power is enabling that same 15-year-old kid to hack into a small bank. And the balance that we strike here, I think, is going to be incredibly delicate and important, but certainly we shouldn't be thoughtless in shifting the balance that we have today. So just that comment. So on information sharing, I wanted to understand a little bit more detail, especially going beyond threat indicators to the possibility of actual incident data, and to see if you might comment on your thoughts on, first of all, is there a general agreement in your industry about the value of sharing, going beyond threat data to actual incident data? To what extent is that specific or highly specific to the financial industry? You know, are there general principles there that would apply to other industry sectors? And given the international footprint of your organizations and many others, what is the actual role that the U.S. government specifically could play in supporting that type of information sharing?
So there is a lot of information sharing occurs, as we talked about earlier, within the Financial Services Information Sharing Analysis Center. That is not just about the sharing of threat indicators for the benefit of all the institutional members. There's a larger number of other constructs within the FSISEC, everything from conferences and forums where people meet and share best practices through to specific committees. For example, there is a threat intelligence committee and various other working groups where particular patterns of attacks or issues and responses to that can be shared amongst member institutions. So there's already a lot of that happening. The sharing of information about incidents, how to respond, and what the lessons learned from that is a lot less structured than the sharing of specific threat indicators that tend to be, by definition, more structured and amenable to fast interchange. But a lot of work is happening in that respect. The other thing I would say, and this was echoed, I think, by all of us in our opening remarks, is there's a large degree of trust and sharing between all of the different teams in each institution. This is something where all firms, I think, believe this is about the protection of the sector, not just any one individual firm. And so, notwithstanding any formal sharing arrangements, there's a lot of collaboration amongst teams, along with all of our vendors and all of the other components of our supply chain for a shared defense of the sector. The things where we're going to continue to explore is how do we get more structured in the sharing of things above the basic sharing of threats, and that's still a work in progress.
So I'm going to try to grab a few comments that you've said that went on. Each one of you brought up the public-private sharing. Steve posited we don't have the government in the right place, perhaps. Annie brought out a great point about 9/11, and are we headed in a similar place with respect to the financial sector and perhaps the country? And so there were four key things that I took that you guys have said as we're going into this, and I want to make sure I have them right, because I do think they are key points that the commission can act on. The first was clarity of government roles, and Tom, you brought that up. Do we have that clarified? Who's going to respond when? And do we exercise that? And I think it really gets to the second point. We need an aggressive way of industry and government working together, planning it, exercising it, testing it, doing it by sector, doing it cross-sector, doing it with the government, and doing it internationally. And you all brought those up. Mm-hmm. And I think the other part that came out was criminal. And it goes back to some of Steve and what's peppering us. What can we do to take on the criminal hacks that are going and mounting, and we're seeing those grow at, you know, I think exponentially? Is there something that the government can do in partnership with industry to go after that like we did organized crime many years ago? Are those all about right, or do you want to change any?
The only thing I would add would be, and I think this is something you're obviously familiar with, is the authorities, the frameworks of authorities by which that can be put together.
Right. Yeah, I just had a question, thank you, on the international and global side of this discussion. Kind of connects a little bit to what we were saying here. In the physical world, we've got rules of the road that people don't always ascribe to, but the Geneva Convention, for example, creates rules around how you can treat a prisoner. Driving on a road tells you you've got to use mirror signal maneuver, seat belts, and the like. In this world, where the Internet of Things is going to be billions of devices, the 15-year-old example here, who creates these rules of the road? And internationally, do we need the equivalent of a Geneva Convention, even if it takes us years to get there, to have at least like-minded states and actors behaving along a certain set of parameters and rules that enable companies like yours to truly play out your role globally and help with the development of the Internet of Things? It's a hairy issue. It probably will take years, but is it something we should be thinking about as a commission?
So I think short answer, yes, and I think actually when you look at some of the things that, and again, I'm not sure if you're looking at other departments, but when you look at some of the work the State Department has been doing on norms and some of the work that some private sector companies and some of the kind of research think tanks like the East-West Institute, there's actually been a lot of work on thinking about norms in this space. I'm not a particular expert on that to comment enough, but I'm aware that the State Department have been driving a lot of that.
It's very immature.
It's interesting. The international piece was not a specific part of the mandate in the executive order, but I think through our discussions and interaction, we also were given the flexibility to add aspects. I do think that we'll add this to the commission's deliberations. That is, looking at this issue of norms, what are the mechanisms by which they can be put in place internationally, and Keith, to address the concept of deterrence as well. What can we learn from other norm-setting exercises, including in the nuclear nonproliferation area, for example, over time? And what kinds of steps, it goes to Stephen's point, what kinds of steps can the government take to enhance deterrence in terms of protecting our national assets? So we've formally added that to our list of areas where we're going to seek to put together recommendations.
Great.
Kirsten. I'm sorry, Pat.
I just wanted to follow up on the global question. In your experience, when you're all in a global business, do you see that the biggest headwinds come from the international nature of the markets and business, in other words, the private sector side of the global, or is it because in operating internationally and you're running into government issues? In other words, you know, jurisdictions, different regulatory schemes, things of that type. What's the sense of balance in terms of what's the most difficult part about the global side of this?
A headwind is the regulatory thing you just brought up. Sort of appropriately around the globe, regulators are increasingly trying to understand how to do oversight of cybersecurity. They can end up taking very different approaches, right? So as a global institution, you need to meet the requirements of all your regulators. If we could have leadership in terms of harmonization around, you know, this, progress has been made. You know, if you go to certain countries around the globe, the NIST framework is actually well accepted outside the borders of the United States. In a number of countries, we're strongly supportive, as are global industry associations, of both harmonization as a general matter and then the NIST as useful. NIST is actually, as you probably are aware, even thinking about not having it branded as a U.S. Government product, but it being a framework that is basically good generic approach to cybersecurity and therefore adoptable, you know, in a global fashion. So that would help, especially if regulators could find their way to more common approaches and oversight.
Just an observation, and I'm asking you for a recommendation to the commission. I mean, the observation is in all these areas is that things are making progress, but really slow. And therefore, we're not moving fast enough to use Stephen's term, defend ourselves. We're not moving fast enough. So if you could tell us one thing we could recommend to speed things up to the future president, what would that be?
It's always difficult to pick one thing. But I think, and again, this may be vaguer than you're asking, but I think just to keep doubling down on the NIST cybersecurity framework and really driving more pervasively amongst sector-specific agencies and NIST to derive specific profiles of the NIST cybersecurity framework that ally more closely with some of the baseline control definitions to make the, what is a great framework more specific and standards-based for what is that expected default level of control. Now, again, not that a baseline of control is going to defend all things, but it may defend many things, and I think taking the framework into a profile of controls, I think, is probably going to be the most useful thing. Correct.
Just to make sure I understand, Phil, as we're talking, my experience with the NIST framework, and I use it, Pat, so just so you get it down, I think it's great. but I do think where I see companies struggling with it is what you just brought out, and I want to make sure I have it right. It's the metrics. How do you know that you've actually done this control right? And it's right now we don't have enough specificity, it's easy for you to say, to the standards to know have they met it, and for the smaller companies to do it. Go ahead.
So I'll give you one example. So some of the work, and again, this may be worthwhile you guys meeting with some of the industry associations, because SIFMA, the Securities Industry Financial Markets Association, has been partnering with many of us on developing large firm and small firm profiles of the NIST framework. And then there's been there's a lot of ongoing partnership with the AICPA and the audit firms around how to construct an audit framework to put specific measures so that somebody can get an audited framework when they declare NIST cybersecurity conformance to a particular profile. So I think there's a path to take this to the next step that will enable us to actually have companies' ability to claim conformance actually be verified in an appropriate way, which is probably also going to help us in supply chain verification and other aspects of risk management.
I realize I've said this, and sharing threat indicators is it's blocking and tackling, but information sharing and what that legislation was about, that vision's not a reality today. And so I think tactically accelerating all the activities that relate to automating, systematizing, even just threat indicator content across sectors and with the government is something that I think would make a very big difference, has very high return and relatively low cost compared to many other things. I realize it isn't sexy, but we haven't done it. So we have a vision, but the vision's not a reality.
So first, I concur with Phil, and then I really hope the commission focuses on resources, right? If in 2016, we look back over the last decade, I think we actually understand the problem reasonably well, and that, certainly you should be exploring the key dimensions of the problem and what are the challenges. But if the investment is not at the level of the challenge, to respond, I mean, if you look at, I won't use specific numbers, but if you look at the president's announced budget for investment in this area, and you look at other national security challenges, I think you may find a mismatch in terms of the level of investment. I do think, for our sector, dedicated capabilities like other industry sectors have in terms of government support, as I mentioned in my opening remarks, also may be one of the places where investment might be well placed.
Just wanted to follow up on something that you just said, Phil, regarding supply chain, because that's something that we're looking at and addressing. And clearly, when you're looking at your industry, supply chain plays a critical role in that. And so when you're looking at cybersecurity, what are you looking for in your supply chain as baseline levels of cybersecurity, and has the NIST framework played a role in that? The question I was going to ask at the outset was just about supply chain, but then you referenced the framework and looking at small and medium-sized businesses. Do you have baseline levels of requirement for your supply chain and cyber, and are those baselines something that we could translate to other sectors as well as to the government?
Yeah, so I would say all financial institutions have a formal assessment program to look at all of the vendors in their supply chain, risk rank them, and then subject them to appropriate scrutiny all the way from on-site reviews, independent audits, down to other forms of assessment. So I think that's happening today. I don't think yet there's a, despite a number of industry initiatives over the years, there's yet one single set of baseline controls we all universally apply. And that creates probably quite a large amount of overhead in the commercial sector as every firm checks every other firm with perhaps slightly different standards. Again, there's a hope that we'll get to that with the profiles of the framework to enable us to come up with those kind of standards. There's also emerging private companies that enable, it's probably not appropriate to mention names of companies in this forum, but there's a series of private companies that provide online assessments and reviews, not necessarily penetration tests, but using publicly available information can come up with ratings around a particular company's security posture, not as deep as you would get with a true on-site assessment. But what's increasingly happening is companies are fusing information from assessments from these online ratings to develop a portfolio rating of all their different supply chain risks. We would like to get to an approach where there is some basic standards, but I don't think even when there's standards, it will let companies off the hook of having a lot of responsibility to look at their suppliers and make sure they're managing the risk, because you, even though you're putting things in the supply chain, you still have to keep the responsibility to manage those things for your customers and your own risk.
Each one of us does exactly what Phil described, more or less independently. Right. So we have a set of standards that we take something like the NIST framework, we go down multiple levels of specificity to the general's point, and we inspect companies based on their risk ratings. It includes, in some cases, on-site visits, physical inspections of data centers, and so forth. The companies that do the scorecard, and these are startups that I referenced earlier that may not even be visible to many in the industry, but essentially each of us repeats more or less the same process to many of the same suppliers. Now, in theory, there's a huge inefficiency in that. It does benefit other companies that use those same suppliers. Like I mentioned earlier, some of the cloud providers, you know, we've each taken them through their paces, so to speak, and have raised the level of play. But there's a huge inefficiency in that process today.
That's interesting. On the point you raised, I just want to make sure we have it right. So we have this framework, which has been fairly successful. You're advocating that we extend it and basically choose a set of appropriate guidance with respect to kind of baseline controls identify them, choose, and seek that as a standard going forward. And then in your testimony, you also said that it could be subject to appropriate certification schemes. Could you spend a couple of minutes on that?
Right. So yeah, this is what I was mentioning just in the comments before, which is around once you've developed a profile of the framework and then chosen the specific controls within that that you'll define as a baseline, it's then useful to be able to have somebody, either yourself under some framework or have a third party attest to the fact that you're maintaining those controls. Typically in the audit space through the AICPA, there are various different standards for how controls can be claimed and attested. There are things like for financial controls, things like SSA 16. There are various other audit frameworks. So essentially taking a framework, controls, putting them in, if you like, a wrapper of how you audit against that, so companies can then be subject to third-party audit around your claim controls.
Right. Would you advocate that as also, maybe we won't be able to answer this, as a policy matter, would you advocate that being a formal disclosure in SEC filings?
I think in practice, I don't think that may not be necessary, because what happens is many companies already, through for their own risk management reasons or for regulatory reasons, are already providing and consuming these things from each other anyway, and so having that as a formal layer will kind of help us not just raise the baseline, but also in decrease the efficiency of inefficiency of supply chain risk assessment.
Right. Let me build on Tom's point, but you guys are heavily supervised. I won't use the term you don't like, so call it supervised, right? other industries aren't so heavily supervised. So would you have the same recommendation if you were thinking about like the retail industry per se, where they don't have the same level of would you have some disclosure of some kind? Would it be a requirement like you guys have? It has to go to the audit committee of the board, therefore the full board, as you all know, because you have to make these presentations. Would you think about it differently if you weren't heavily supervised?
No, I think our supervision is very good, and it aligns with our own natural desire to manage these risks because of the nature of our businesses. When you look across other sectors, there are plenty of sectors where you do see equivalently effective supervision. There are some sectors, though, where it's probably more market transparency for the customers that use those products and services that may be the biggest force for correction.
Right. I wouldn't lose a point I think somebody made earlier that we've talked a lot about the NIST framework. It's very, very good. We do have supervisor oversight from a number, in our case, a number of different regulators that each come at the cyber problem slightly differently. They do collaborate, but they do come at it slightly differently, and I think that would be true of other industries with different regulators. So while the NIST standard, I think, is finding its way across the sort of supervisory spectrum, I would say there continues to be an opportunity to streamline and simplify the way in which we face the regulatory regimes specific to cyber. Because we it's not one interaction, it's multiple interactions.
Is that, how big of a problem is that? I'm sitting here thinking I've never heard the financial services presentation seem so happy with their regulatory regime. But they, but it seems like a lot of it works. But Marc, you raised the point about multiplicity of regulators. And are there conflicts issues? Are you having to respond to competing or different kinds of direction, given the multiplicity of regulators that your entities have?
I think they do. They actually work together. So they actually do try to work together to bring a common view. But that said, each of them has independent responsibility for assessing our security capabilities. And so we're under sort of constant inspection, you know, pretty much through the course of the year. And I think there's an opportunity within this framework to contemplate, would there be a more simplified, streamlined approach? And that's just within financial services, by the way. I think the same challenge extends across other regulated industries.
Just to add to that, would you say that in the response side of that framework, there is less cooperation between the regulatory agencies as compared to the prevention side of it? So something bad happens. You've got local police, state police, Secret Service, FBI, everybody and their grandfather comes across to you with a different perspective of what they need from you. Would that help you? Would something like this help you sort through that?
And it goes back to, actually, what I found is that each of those entities, extremely well-intentioned and actually is trying to help us. But we do get variation in the response, for sure, and sometimes not always consistent. Not always consistent perspective. So I do think back to the sort of role clarity across the attack spectrum. I think at least here in these spaces, Homeland Security, in our case, Treasury, FBI, local enforcement to a lesser degree, are all there to help and actually provide very good resources and capabilities and mindset. But there's still some confusion about who has what role. But
right. But, and yeah. One thing I do think we should probably keep straight is supervisory, you know, responsibilities of the regulators, including our ability to respond, but versus response in a specific situation where we have obligations to regulators and to law enforcement and, you know, the set of different, you know, legal obligations that we have to carry out. So the point's been made, I think, on our regulatory supervision. Harmonization would be good, right? And you know, the Sector Coordinating Council has called out, you know, asking for, you know, both participation with the regulators on the creation of frameworks with NIST as a sort of a guiding, you know, first point of departure. I guess I'll put it that way, which we believe would help everybody going forward.
So it seems to me an interim step versus going to regulation might be, and Randy brought it out in his testimony coming up, is helping the insurance industry come up with a standard that the insurance industry can look at. It seems to me that with the financial sector being so far ahead of the other sectors and what you've done and the amount of resources you've committed, there can be significant help in helping to set that standard, especially refining the NIST framework to something that's measurable. And I think that we'll go into our next panel. That might be the first, most logical step.
we're coming at the end of our time here. We may have a couple of questions from people who aren't here yet. But one of the specific elements we were asked to look at, and it really, I think, rings even more true listening to you here today, is to have a public awareness aspect to our set of recommendations as well going forward for the next president, next administration. I wanted to get your comments on that. And one thing powerfully came forward today, which is that this issue around standards and choosing a baseline set of controls and the power of doing that is really something the federal government needs to focus on as well. You know, one of our goals on this commission is to try to, as an aspirational matter, get the federal government to become a model as opposed to an entity that where a lot of problems are cited. That's a big task, but over 5 or 10 years should be something we can aim towards. Frankly, because it's not there today. But I think that some of the core points you make about how you run your organizations are very much applicable to federal government, and we'll certainly draw on that. But any comments on the advisability of a public awareness campaign with respect to cybersecurity?
I think consumer education, I think to that point, is going to continue to be important. So not only do institutions, because of their own risk and regulation, need to put forth secure products into the marketplace, it's definitely helpful when those products are demanded in secure ways by consumers. And if that's going to be an education campaign or a underwriter's laboratory style approach where we can make transparent what the security level of a particular consumer product across any sector is, raising that awareness, creating that transparency, and making sure there's market operations for this is going to be important.
I think we're strong supporters. I also, you know, certainly am aware that we have national awareness campaigns in cyber already. I think it's another aspect of the national action plan this year about strengthening, you know, individual accounts, which is largely an education campaign. The commission's strengthening those things for consumers. And I might add, you know, awareness for those who provide internet services about, you know, the use of secure methods in providing services like email. There's simple things that could be adopted that would make it a safer environment. That stressing the growing number, we've talked about startups. There are a lot of companies that are pushing to give people the ability to use the internet more fully, that, you know, making sure that they also leverage safety as something that they're providing along with the services, I think would be very useful.
So two of our commissioners who couldn't be here had submitted questions, Herb Lynn and Joe Sullivan. You've answered a lot of Herb's questions. I do want to raise one of Joe's that had with a follow-on, which is, what could the federal government do to help reduce your cost of building a good digital security? Is there anything other than legislation through actions that the government can do to support the financial sector?
I think you've touched on this in a few of the questions, but it's for government to be a more forceful procurer of the right things to increase the supply of those things in the market that then subsequently decrease our cost. A lot of the times across our supply chain, it's the financial sector that are the forceful procurer of the higher level of standard. We'd certainly like government to be there as well.
And the other follow-on that we had talked about with him was, what are the major innovations that are on the horizon that you foresee to impact the financial sector and that you are thinking about as you're looking 3, 5, 10 years down the road?
I think I touched briefly on tokenization, various ways of encrypting and securing payments credentials, basically mobile commerce, I think clearly represents an opportunity to build security in. I mean, I think back to the awareness question, I think building awareness is very important, but I think it's incumbent on in many cases, the private sector to really build security capabilities in where the value propositions for consumption are compelling and what you get with it is better security. I think that's really an opportunity for us.
The powerful point you made earlier, Marc, about the UL kind of concept. Randy in his paper talks about the Institute for Highway Safety. There are models here where we can try to get this to get these products right from the start with respect to security and privacy. I think it's a powerful point, much appreciated. Anything else from commissioners? So, thank you for your time, and this morning. I know it's incredibly valuable. Your contributions today were really terrific, and we really, really appreciate you and your institutions making them available to us today.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. We appreciate it.